Philippians in chapter number, is this on, brother? Am I on? This is the power of God. This is where the power of God's at. You thought this preacher got us to get right here from this little box. All right. Philippians chapter number 4. And I thought tonight, we'd work on a little study. Years ago, I put this Bible study together. And I found it to be comforting. It's just good to chew on, meditate on. A lot of times we as preachers will come to the pulpit and we're always thinking of life-changing sermons. You know, I want to change your life. Can you imagine how many times your life has been changed? I've been changed so many times I don't even know who I am. You know? But really, the Christian life is just a matter of maintaining faithfulness to the things that you've been taught. And really what a preacher will do, like Pastor this morning, is he's reminding you. Think about how many times Paul said, I write to remind you. In some way or another, he made that phrase, because there's really not a lot of new. In fact, there is no new truth. But there's not in our Christian life. The difficulty is not learning new; it's maintaining what we've learned. And you're really not going to learn anything anyway until the Spirit of God opens your eyes to it. You know, otherwise. It's like Charlie Brown language when a preacher is preaching or you're reading the Bible. Wah, 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 wah. You're not understanding.
That is right.
But whenever the Spirit of God opens your eyes to see it, then wow, how powerful it is. Same passages you've read, same sermons, perhaps truths you've heard, but that time it hit home because of what you were going through in your life. And you knew it, but you didn't understand how to apply it to your life. And so tonight I thought I would take a few moments and just talk about chapter number 4. Paul gives us really a clear outline in chapter number 4. And I find it fascinating because as far as we know, this is the last book that Paul wrote. It's another one of his prison epistles. At the writing of this book, Paul was in house arrest. And he was allowed some visitors coming back and forth. We understand Onesimus and Epaphroditus, they were back and forth. We know there was some involvement, but that he actually led Onesimus to Christ. And so it's a very sobering time in Paul's life. He's thinking about the end. And he writes the book of Philippians with a tremendous burden on his back because the church of Philippi was divided. Can you imagine that, a church having contention? I can't imagine that. I've just never seen it in all my life. You know, in all the years I've been in church, I've never seen a church divide or people even get upset inside of a church. But this church was divided. And there was tremendous division. And the icon of their division, the poster child of their division was Paul. They were divided over Paul. Some were saying, oh, that Paul, we told him he shouldn't go to Rome. We told him that he shouldn't do that. And others of them, they in turn have found confidence in Paul's bondage, and they in turn were being bold for Christ and doing the will of God as they had never done before. And Paul said in chapter 1, he says, whether in pretense or truth, he said, I don't care, Christ is preached. And that's what I care about. But division in the church is a big issue. And if there's division in the church, then it's going to kill the church. The unity is a sign that people are yielded to the Spirit. I guess it could also be a sign of an occult, you know, could be. You know, Hitler had unity, didn't he? But true unity is not uniformity like we would see in amongst the Germany during the Nazi regime. But true unity is not uniformity. Everybody looks the same, walks the same, talks the same, acts the same. But true unity is not about uniformity, but it's about you and I agreeing on the same thing. Now, obviously, we're not going to agree on everything together, but there are the greater things that we can focus on. Amen? And Paul dealt with this in chapter 1 and verse number 27. We strive together for the faith of the gospel. And so we gather here because we want to please Christ with our life. We believe the Word of God is true. We want to obey the Word of God. We want to do what God wants us to do. And there's no reason to sit and pick at our differences. And that's immature. That's a sign of immature Christianity. But what's a sign of maturity is dwelling in unity. And so our doctrine is what enables us to have unity. And so he gets to chapter number 4, which is the last chapter of the last book that we know that he has written. And he gives us 6 or 7 things here in this chapter. And I entitled the message, Maintaining Rightness with God. It's maintaining rightness with God. I enjoy what Pastor's been teaching on Sunday morning about spiritual. How does he title that? Knowing if you're spiritual, or
you think you are.
Do you think you're spiritual, or
do you know that you know?
No, I think it has something to do with being spiritual. And he's been teaching on this since I've been coming for some weeks now. This, of course, these last weeks has been on the subject of prayer. But I just want to touch on a few things that really just highlight our life overall about maintaining a rightness with Him. Let's read, if we will. I wasn't there in the passage. Let me read chapter 4 and verse number 1. Therefore, my dearly beloved and longed for, my joy and crown, so stand fast. I'm sorry, please stand. Stand fast in the Lord, my dearly beloved. I beseech Eudaeus and beseech Syntyche that they be of the same mind in the Lord. And I treat thee also, true yoke fellow. Help those women which labor with me in the gospel, with Clement also, and with other my yoke fellow laborers whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say rejoice. Let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. Let's pray. Father, we're grateful for your words, and we pray that you would enable us to have a greater understanding, especially for us, where we are in our life today. And that's your scripture is relevant. And you purposely wrote it so that we could find faith and strength in the Word of God. And we pray that tonight that you would grant us that strength and that strengthening of our faith and refreshing of our spirits so that we can maintain a faithfulness to you till our day's end. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Though we believe, and we all would agree, that our sins are forgiven, And I'm no longer seeking to get forgiveness of my sins. My sins were completely forgiven, past, present, and future, whenever I came to Jesus Christ back in 1981 at Liberty Baptist Church in Princeton, West Virginia. And I knelt down and called upon Jesus Christ, repenting and turning unto Him for salvation. At that moment, what separated me from God was my sin. Not just the sin that I had committed, but all the sin I would commit. And we would believe that salvation is eternal, and therefore all sins had to be paid for in order for salvation to be eternal. And at that time, I gained, if you will, eternal life. He that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. And Jesus Christ came to live within me, and I, in turn, begin that process of being the new man, that, in turn, I still am the new man and living that way. But I'll admit, I have had a battle and a struggle, as all of us could attest. As Paul said, the things I want to do, I don't. The things I do want to do, I do. Can I get amen on that? Amen. And we understand that struggle. Everybody, that's a normal struggle. A normal struggle. And I want to be right with God. I want, when I get up in the morning, my life and my heart and my mind to be right with God. When I go to bed at night, I want to be right with God. I don't want to live my days. I don't want to go to bed at nighttime not having a rightness with my God. My God deserves that, and I, in turn, want to live within His favor. I want to please Him, and I know that I'm speaking, I'm echoing exactly how all of you feel as well. And I believe that Paul is writing. Now understand, when he penned the book of Philippians, he's penning from this position of disunity in the church and the division that was taking place, the self-will. He speaks in chapter number 2 that all men seek their own things and not the things of Christ. And there was tremendous division in the midst of doing the work of God. And chapter number 4, he leaves for us what I feel is a good outline for how we can maintain maintain and keep our rightness with God. In verse number 6, he begins by saying, be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And here he deals with our prayer life, that we should pray right, that right prayer should be a part of our life. And not that I want to re-preach pastor's message this morning, but certainly it's good to re-emphasize the idea or the concept that prayer should be a part of our life. And I like what pastor said in the introduction this morning, that in turn we will never be what we should be for God until prayer is an intimate part of our life. And I think we all could look back over our lives and we could attest that those times when we were cold and those times when we struggled and those times when we perhaps were struggling with besetting sins, that we also could identify that prayer was not a part of our life. And here Paul says, be careful for nothing. In other words, in everything in our life, we should bathe it with prayer and bathe it with supplication. You know, one man said, why worry when you can pray? Easy to say, but it's really hard to do. Why worry when you can pray? And Jesus echoed these words in Matthew 14, watch ye and pray, lest ye enter into temptation. The spirit truly is ready, but the flesh is weak. Again, pastor read this verse this morning, Luke 18 and verse number 1. He said, Jesus spake a parable to them, that men ought always to pray and not to faint. Fainting Christians is a reflection of Christians that are not praying. And we could, we could take the time to deal with the mechanics of prayer. I'm not so sure the mechanics of prayer is what's important. I think the fact that you are praying is what is important. You know, the Bible says, pray without ceasing. And I know for me that there was a period of time in my life that I had become so mechanical with my prayers that I had a structure, a good structure for how I prayed, and I had a schedule, a good schedule for how I prayed. But then once I did that, it was almost as though I was a good Catholic. I just checked that off my list and I went on. I wasn't walking with God through my day. You know, part of you and I maintaining rightness with our God is prayer. Those communication lines must stay open. When you get into your car, I encourage you should stop it. You and your spouse, or if you're by yourself, pray. Lord, thank you for my car. And I pray you give us safety as we go home. You start your work day. My boys and I do a little bit of mowing the grass. And for we, this one right here is the one that always reminds me and is real good about that. Well, we stop and gather together and we pray, God, keep us safe. You know, we're running this equipment and we're mowing. We thank you that we can work and get sweat and we have something to do right now. Please keep us safe. You know, prayer is not, it's not just for the foxhole experiences in your life. But prayer should be something that we always are doing. When the phone rings, many, many times before I answered, I pray and said, Lord, I need wisdom. This common phone conversation, I think maybe I know what they want to talk about. Give me wisdom when I talk to them. We should be so used to acknowledging God in every area of our life all the time. Paul said, in all things, be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. Acts chapter 12 and verse number 12, and you need not turn there. It's just, I want to make points. You remember the story. It's for the time when Peter was in prison. The church gathered to pray. And it was amazing to see how that these Christians were praying and they're seeking the Lord. And as Pastor mentioned this morning, as they were praying, the Holy Spirit or the angel of God met with Paul and the chains fell off and delivered him. And Paul in turn was then, or Peter, I'm sorry, Peter then was delivered back to the congregation. You know, it's important to pray about these matters, these serious matters. But, and those matters oftentimes get our attention in prayer. But it's important that we pray about all things. You know, something's troubling you. What is this troubling you tonight? I got a phone call in the course of this day. And after I got the phone call, I felt like a wet blanket was on me. I was bothered. Irritated. It's probably a good word. And I don't want to live like that. You know, God will help me, and I need God's help, I need God's provision. And so I went to prayer, and I said, Lord, you know how I'm feeling about this, and I'm asking for your help. And again, it's not, the mechanics of it is not what the issue is I'm dealing with. It's the idea, are you praying? Are you praying? My grandmother, who was a person that really changed my life, I didn't grow up in a Christian home. I have a very loving mother, but my mother wasn't a Christian walking in the Word of God. And I had a grandmother that she was a God-fearing lady. She loved the Lord. She attended church. She was a founding member of the church, which I was referring to earlier, my home church. And my grandmother would pray for me. She'd pray for me to get saved. She'd pray and pray and pray. And then later, I did get saved. And then later, she began to pray that the Lord would call me into the ministry. Lord, I'm praying and asking that you'll call Mark. My grandmother was a very simple lady. She, had a third grade education. She could hardly write. She wasn't necessarily an intelligent lady, but she wasn't very confident to speak or confident to do anything because she wasn't well educated. My grandmother in church, she never taught a Sunday school class. She never, sang a special in church. Truthfully, she don't think she ever really did anything in the church. But my grandmother prayed. In her last years, we put a monitor by her bedside, one of those baby monitors, and then put a monitor in the master bedroom, and you would listen. As for hours every day, as my grandmother laid in bed, she'd pray. And she would pray for her grandchildren, pray for her children, pray for people that come to her mind. She understood the importance of prayer. I'm not like that. I pray that God will help me to grow in prayer. I know prayer is important. And Paul said, be careful for nothing, but in everything. But in everything, by prayer and supplication. Every decision. You realize that there are no small decisions in life. Abraham was sent his servant to go and find a bride for his son Isaac. And here we see Rachel. She makes her way out to gather water, and she sees Abraham's servant and says to him, can I water your camel? Such a small decision. But it changed her life. Because of that decision, she in turn became part of the lineage of Jesus Christ. There are no small decisions. And that's why it's important that we pray about everything. Everything, that we immerse it in prayer and talk to God about it. And talk to God just as if you would talk to another person. Certainly with respect, certainly. But just as you would communicate with your Father, with reverence, that you would communicate with God the same. And so we see here that prayer should be an active part, a regular active part of our life, all the time, every day, without ceasing it. Meaning that we can always, any time, just pray. Just stop and pray. In our thoughts, out loud, while we're driving a car, before we pick up the phone, at the supper table. And I'm not underestimating that there shouldn't be times in the morning or even that you walk with God and pray. But that shouldn't be the only time. We should pray about everything all day long. We're just constantly in communication with God in prayer. Preacher I greatly admired in the past, he's now with the Lord. But many times he would step up to the pulpit, or maybe he would be with a group of people, and he would go to pray, and he would start off his prayers by saying, "And Father." His prayers always started with, "And Father." reason is because he didn't stop talking to God. He had been talking to God prior. And so rightness with God includes us praying right. Look at verse number 8 says, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. This I find to be the most convicting passage in the New Testament. That the thoughts that I will harbor in my mind are thoughts that in turn should run through this screening or this filter. They should be true and honest and just and lovely and good report and virtue and praise. Those are the things I should think upon. Now, think with me, if you will, just in a course of a normal day about things that we allow our minds to think about. We allow ourselves many times to think on things that we don't know that really are true. But we are afraid that perhaps it could happen. We allow ourselves to be duped by perhaps media and begin to think upon things that are dishonest and things that are not pure. The Bible says the things they do in darkness that we're not even supposed to talk about amongst ourselves. And yet we meditate upon all the things, the evil deeds that people are doing. And we glorify that. We want to see that picture. We want to hear what happened. What took place? The Bible says the things that they do, the wicked deeds they do, we should not even talk about them. We shouldn't even think about them. Meditate on those. Obviously, there's communication about people's testimony back and forth that are slanderous. And perhaps we don't even know that they are true. And yet there's, in the course of the day, I've been guilty, and I'm sure I will be guilty again, of participating in such things. And so here we see that Paul is narrowing down our thought life. He said it should be things that are of good report, of virtue, of praise. Of course, that praise is directed, giving honor, doing honors due, and primarily unto God. It should be just. It should be honest. It should be true. Now, I want you to look with me, Will, because it's important to note this in 2 Corinthians in chapter number 10. Second Corinthians chapter number 10. Are you there? Say amen. Just a few books over. Three books over. Okay, chapter 10 and in verse number 3 says, For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Casting down what?
Imagination.
What is it?
Imagination.
And every high thing that exalted itself against the what?
Knowledge
of God. And bring into captivity every what?
Thought.
I want you to notice here, it speaks in this passage, imaginations, knowledge, and thoughts. The point being is that the battle of the Christian life is in the mind. That's what Paul was saying. We don't wrestle against flesh and blood. We're wrestling against something greater than that. That's spiritual warfare. And spiritual warfare is taking place right here in thoughts. And we pull down those strongholds. We, in turn, we take negative thoughts, we take unjust thoughts, we take wicked thoughts, we take these bad thoughts, these impure thoughts, these sinful thoughts, these slanderous thoughts, these thoughts that are not of a good report of another man. We take these thoughts and we subdue them and we replace them with right thoughts. Right thoughts. Thoughts about God's word, certainly. Thoughts about what God is doing in our life, certainly. I promise you, you don't have to think about those things. We can think about God. We can think about God's goodness. But if, as Paul said, or Peter said, we cannot help but speak the things that we have seen and heard. And, you know, we ingest through our eyes and through our ears, we ingest much material that generates thoughts in our mind. And those thoughts, in turn, become really that they wrestle. We wrestle with it. They bring temptations. They rob our faith. They cause us to struggle with anger, jealousy, malice, etc., etc. And so Paul was saying in 2 Corinthians that our warfare, our battle, is taking place inside of our mind. And I'm sure that all of us could tell a story about thoughts that were in our mind that in turn created a scenario, a bad situation, and to come to find out it wasn't even true. Wasn't even true. Our thoughts can arrest us. And so we want to guard our mind. Rightness with God is not only involves praying right, that we're praying without ceasing, about everything. We're just constantly. Our prayers begin by saying, "And God," denoting that we've been talking to God all through the day. All through the day. That God's not just, we just don't have our formal conversation with Him as our boss when we clock into work, but all day long we communicate with Him because He's with us all day long. But rightness with God denotes that we think right. You know, the way you think is the way you feel. And the way you feel is what you do. Actions are always a reflection of thoughts. And so we can shortcut the correction of our actions. We can shortcut it by just having good thoughts. The Bible is very clear that the Word of God is that which cleans our thoughts. Cleans it. Thereby, we must meditate on the Bible. We must reread the Bible. We must hear the Bible taught. It's good to listen to the Bible. It's good to sing the Bible. It's good to communicate. That's good conversation to have, even amongst yourself. A good discipline to practice, husband and wife, when you come to church. Nothing wrong with talking about cars or guns or sports or things of this sort, but we should have a discipline that we practice to talk about something that God has taught us from Scriptures. And yet, it's interesting how awkward that feels at times to try to communicate a scriptural thought to someone. I was talking to a man the other day in a church, and he's been in the church generations. I don't know. He's been here for many years, long time. And I cornered him and began to talk to him about scripture and get him into a scripture conversation. And it was just he was fumbling around. It was awkward to him. He wasn't comfortable have this conversation about scriptures, and I'm not condemning the man when I say that, but we should become comfortable with communicating God's word. Make it a discipline in life. Come to church and say, "Brother so-and-so, let me show you what God gave me in scripture the other day. Let me show you this verse of scripture I memorized. Hey, sister so-and-so, I read this verse the other day. What do you think that God was really saying in there?" These things, you're not going to control your thoughts just because you're a good person. You'll control your thoughts because you put disciplines in your life. And we're much like horses. You got to put blinders on the eyes of horses to keep them from being distracted. And we likewise need to put up blinders of the Word of God to keep ourselves from being distracted by all the things going on in this world and in family, the sin, and so forth and so on. And so we want to pray right. We want to think right. These things are real important. Even our thinking at times can become so negative because of problems in our own life. We're going through perhaps health problems or relationships problems or whatever would be the case. And yet the Bible says, "Casting all your care upon Him, for He careth for you." And it's just that simple. You know, we go to the feet of Christ, and we lay down at His feet all of our cares, and we in turn pick up this new man, the new life that we have. No matter what happens, we're not getting out of this world without dying unless He raptures us. unless he raptures, you're going to die one way or another. And so that's just the reality of it. But yet this world, all the scenarios and situations of the world can arrest us and make us just live in worry. Where we just skip from one worry to the next and one distress to the next and live that way. Gracious me, I don't want to live that way. And here we see verse number 5, and the peace of God which passes all understanding shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. And that's how I want to. I want to live with God's peace keeping me. And that involves praying right. That involves thinking right. Alright? Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6 and verse number 25 that we should take no thought. Take no thought what you shall eat or what you shall wear. Boy, sometimes I've read that. That's powerful. If he doesn't want me to take thought about what I eat or what I wear, then probably he doesn't want me to take thoughts of those things which are not immediate things. And it's not that God wants me to live carelessly, flying by the seat of my pants. That God wants me to live trusting him. All I can do is all I can do. And the rest has to be put in the hands of God. You can do no more than what you can do. Control your thoughts. Christ went on to say in Matthew chapter 6, he said, you know, what man can change? You know, people can change anything. I mean, you can't change anything. I can't change anything at all. I certainly can make a mess of my life, but in reality, I can't change anything. And so why be consumed with all of these thoughts that are negative and evil and wicked and unjust and of good report? And I understand that the temptation is great to hear about the negative. Did you hear what so-and-so's doing? Did you hear what happened at this place? Did you hear what so-and-so, et cetera, et cetera? And I need not fill in the blanks. We know. And that's what Paul's dealing with. We don't want our mind, our thoughts, to be involved in those things. Nor do we want our thoughts to be involved with wondering and worrying about what hasn't happened but what we're afraid is going to happen. We just need to make sure our thoughts are pure and just and honest and good report and full of praise. They're just directed unto God, because that is the battleground for our lives, is our minds. And so we want to pray right and we want to think right. These are two of the things he mentions here. I have a lot of verses, but I'm going to go on. Look at verse number 9, right? Just looking at a short outline here that Paul had written out for us. It says, those things which you have both learned and received and heard and seen in me, do, and the God of peace shall be with you. So we focus on prayer. We focus on our thoughts. But here Paul says, I want you to focus on your work. How hard it is. It's always fun to learn new things. My boys and I, when we first time I took them to mow grass, and they hadn't touched a weed eater, they hadn't touched a blower, they hadn't touched a lawnmower, much less touched any type of riding anything lawnmower. And boy, they were all excited. We want to ride a riding lawnmower. Well, I don't think you're ready for that. Well, we want to run the weed eater. I don't think you're ready for that. I don't think we're ready for that. Well, we want to run the push mower. I don't know that I'm ready for that. I'll let you run the blower. Oh, that's great, Dad. We'll run the blower. And they run the blower, and that was exciting to them. And that lasted for a little while. And then they learned the weed eater and learned the other things, how to run them. But at some point, they got tired of all of those things. And then I found that before, they were so excited and fighting over who could get back to the truck to get the blower out and blow off the sidewalk. They were fighting over who was going to do the weed eater. Now it's the opposite. No, you need to do it. I don't want to do it. No, it's your turn. I don't want to do it. And but now, you know, you bring in a new piece of equipment, something really fancy or nice, you know, like something they can ride or something they haven't done before. They want to learn how to do that. We're no different, are we? Think about all the things you've learned in your Christian life. And I'm looking at some folks here that I'm assuming have been saved for many years. You've learned how to forgive. Are you forgiving? When you first learned it, you practiced it. It's kind of old hat now, isn't it? It's not as fun to forgive as it used to be. You learned that it's wrong to lose your temper. And boy, you felt a lot of conviction about that years ago. How are you doing now with that? And that's what Paul said. He's saying here the things that you have, you've learned and you've heard and you've seen and me do, and the God of peace shall be with you. How profitable is it for us to learn new things if we're not maintaining the old things? You know, the Bible says a picture of the people of the last days is that they're ever learning and never coming to the knowledge of truth. And so learning is a joy. But as James says in verse James 1, it says that we should be doers of the word and not hearers only. And so the purpose of learning is so we can do. And so I encourage you that part of our rightness with God is prayer, focusing on prayer, that prayer should be a part of our everyday life, that we're praying. We focus on it. Folks, you can't pray enough. You can't talk to God more. And about it, thank you, God, for the Coke that I'm drinking. It's probably going to kill me if I drink it. thank you, Lord, for my job. Lord, pray for safety. Lord, my mind. I was just thinking right now about this person, the trial they're going through in their life. Oftentimes, we will say to one another, will you pray for me about this? Will you pray for me about that? And truthfully, we have all good intentions to pray, but then we walk away and forget. Just do it right then. Grab a hold of that brother, put your arm around him and say, let's pray right now. And you're more likely to remember it later. But prayer should be so common. It should be practiced and common with us. And then here Paul says that we should work, should focus on our work, that we're maintaining the things that we have learned in our life. God doesn't hold us accountable for what we haven't learned. Aren't you glad about that? He holds us accountable for what we have learned. And he's taught all of us some wonderful, valuable lessons from his words. We can look to the Bible and identify them. And Paul is saying, I want you to maintain those. Work out those things in your life. Be a picture. Be a testimony. Let it be seen. Let it be known. These things that you have learned. You've had examples. You've had training. You've been motivated. You've had proper teaching. It's been demonstrated. It's been shown to you. Now, don't just be a hearer of everything you've learned. But be a doer of the things that you've learned as well. It's time that you do. Notice we're on verse number 11 as we continue on. Just walking down through the passage. He says here in verse number 11, not that I speak in respect of one, for I have learned in whatsoever state I am therewith to be content. He goes on to say in verse number 12, I know both how to be abased, I know how to abound everywhere in all things. I'm instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound in suffering. It's a great passage on contentment, but when I look at verse number 11, more than contentment, Paul is saying, I've guarded my attitude. I've guarded my spirit. And so Paul here is identifying that we should focus on prayer, that we should focus on our thoughts, protecting our thoughts, that we should focus on our work, that we're maintaining all the things that we've been taught. But here in this verse, he says we should focus on our attitude. Obviously, contentment would be easy if I got everything I wanted when I wanted. Can I get amen on that? Yeah, that would be easy. But that isn't life, and none of us live that way. We really are living more in response or sometimes in reaction to everything in life. And so Paul said it didn't matter what state I was in my life. He said I was content with it. I controlled my attitude. I controlled my spirit. I wasn't bent out of shape and frustrated and irritated and mad because I didn't get this or didn't have that or I didn't get to sleep here or I didn't have food on this day or I didn't get the financial support that was promised to me or because people, they were angry with me and they were fighting me and chasing me out of town. He said, I was content. My attitude, I was able to control it. And perhaps the Lord would give me liberty to talk about contentment in a later day. But in reality, what Paul is saying is I was just satisfied with Christ. I was just satisfied with Christ. He, every need he is supplying, wondrous grace he's bestowing every day. My way seems brighter. The longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. The longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. The more that I love him, more love he bestows. Each day is like heaven. My cup overflows. The longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. And Paul didn't focus upon all those extraneous activities and people and things. He was content because he had what he needed. He had Christ. It's good to have health, but if all you have is Christ, you don't have health, then you have enough to control your attitude and be happy. It's good to have a wonderful marriage. But if you don't have a wonderful marriage, you still can have Christ, and that's all you need to be happy. And I know that seems difficult to walk out and live in your life, but it's true. God is sufficient. And you and I can control our attitude and control our spirit. And again, I'm not pretending as though, and especially in front of my kids, I'm not pretending as though I'm one that always controls my attitude, because I don't. As oftentimes, circumstances and things come, and I respond incorrectly, and I get frustrated, tempted to anger, and say things I shouldn't say. But I shouldn't be so shallow as a person that you could rob my joy. I shouldn't be so simple as a person, as a Christian, that you in turn can control my attitude. I should be stronger than that. And I won't be if I in turn feel like that you have something that I'm supposed to have, or you can take something that I need. As long as my eyes are upon Christ and I'm trusting in his promises, then certainly there's nothing you can do. You can't harm me, and you can't take anything away from me, because I have everything I need in Christ. So Paul here identifies that we should pray, or we should pray about all things. We should focus on our prayers. We should focus on our thoughts, our mind. We in turn should make sure we focus on our work, that we have good works. We're working out. We're maintaining those things which we've been taught in our life. And there he talks about our attitude. Let it be said of you, let it be said of me, that people say, man, it doesn't matter what happens in our life, we're always the same. That's what we should strive for. That our attitude is not up and down and up and down and all over the place and mad and angry and frustrated and happy, and so, but that we have a consistency and constantness about our spirit. I think that's godly. I think it's right. I think it's a reflection of Christ. And I think that's a reflection of our rightness in God. And so we learn to guard our spirit. And then let's look at verse number 13 and verse number 19. I shouldn't give you paper to write these things down tonight. I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. Verse number 19, but my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Now, I would believe that the primary emphasis of this passage is that is missions. And I'm not talking about missions, but I want you to see that Paul's faith was right. He focused on faith. He was doing things that people felt that were impossible, and certainly I believe that Paul felt were impossible. The stonings, the shipwrecks, the imprisonments, the force of the Roman government, the power of the Judaizers, and I mean, Paul faced a lot of opposition in his lifetime, but his mindset was this: I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Because with God, nothing is impossible. And in verse number 19, he says, but my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. And Paul is identifying faith. Faith is our supply line to God's blessings and God's power. And God, our God, isn't limited, but in my life, he is limited by my faith. We're talking about rightness with God. Paul said, I can do all things through Christ, and Christ will supply all things. Identifying that his faith was unwavering in God. He knew that God, in turn, he saw past the physical world and he looked into the spiritual world through the lenses of God's word, through the promises of God's word, and he realized, my He'll provide for me. My God will supply for me. Our faith must be right. And we're not talking about forced faith. We're just talking about as we live our lives, then we face those times that want to rob us, rob our faith with fear, cause us to doubt, that we make a choice to stand on the side of faith. God will take care of us. God will provide for us. God will give me the wisdom I need. God will give me the strength I need. God's will be done. God will answer this prayer. God will help me. God will do this. And we dwell and we walk in faith. And so faith is very, very, very important. Of course, the Bible says that without faith, it is impossible to please Him. And we understand that faith, we walk by it, we live by it, and it's that which pleases God. Look, if you will, in verse number 15 down to verse number 18. Maintaining our rightness with God. Now you Philippians know also that in the beginning of the gospel, when I departed from Macedonia, no church communicated with me as concerning giving and receiving, but ye only. For even in Thessalonica, you sent once and again into my necessity, not because I desire a gift, but I desire fruit that may abound to your account. But I have all and I abound, I'm full. Have received of Epaphroditus the things which were sent unto you, an odor of sweet smell, a sacrifice acceptable and well-pleasing to God. Now, in these verses, Paul is dealing with the financial support, the monies that he received by way of the people. And I thought it was important to include and to identify in this passage here that not only our rightness with God is not only prayer and maintaining our faults and maintaining the things that we've been taught, working right, and our spirit to keep it right, our faith, but here in this verse, we see that we should also understand that rightness with God always has something to do with our pocketbook. And I know I'm not the pastor, but I don't think I'd get in trouble for saying anything about it. If your pocketbook isn't right with God, then you'll never be right with God. It's a great study in scriptures. When Moses came down off the mountain after receiving the Ten Commandments the second time, and he came in amongst the people, the first thing he said was, and I paraphrase, I talked with God and he said, let's take an offering. But you know, giving is important to God. God doesn't need the money, but God in turn is pleased. It shows something about our lives. It shows something about our faith, our passions. It shows something about where our lust versus our faith lies. And so giving is real important. It's also important to God because everything belongs to God. And your children, your wife, your husband, the money in your pocket, the car you're driving, every cattle, all the cows on the side of the hills, they all belong to God. All the gold, everything belongs to God. And when we give to God, what we're acknowledging is everything belongs to you, and that's why I'm giving this to you. Thankfully, and I say that tongue-in-cheek, he doesn't ask us to give everything. And God does tug on our heart about giving, and he does ask us to give a percentage of our money. And yet, we understand that God is faithful, and he in turn always supplies and always gives back. You're never going to be debtor to God. God doesn't need you to fund his work, but he wants us to be involved and to acknowledge that he is the one that's giving to all of us. And so, interesting times I pastored, I found that the last thing that people typically would give would be their money and their growth with God. And when people begin to struggle, the first thing they would take away was their money. And I never knew what anybody gave when I pastored. I didn't want to know, because it probably would bother me. Can I get amen on that? I didn't want to know. But somehow that money becomes so important to them. Understand that what you give to God is between you and God. And I think Pastor Johnson, that's his attitude and philosophy. But your giving is important to God. And maintaining rightness with God is showing a liberal heart in your giving. The giving of your money. It's showing, it's showing that you have a true faith in God and that you acknowledge that God is the one that's giving you health, strength, life, air to breathe, the job that you have, etc. And so maintain this rightness with God. Last, we see in verse number 20, it says, "Now unto God and our Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. Salute every saint in Christ Jesus, the holy, the brethren, which are with me, greet you." Verse 22, "All saints salute you, chiefly they that be of Caesar's household." Verse 23, "The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen." And so, lastly, we see, and I think this ties back in with verse number 4, "Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice," that our praise should be right, that we should focus on praise in the course of our day, that should regularly, that we're acknowledging, not praying to God, but we're praising God, praising Him. You know, you have a near close accident, that's a great time to stop and praise God.
Right. Amen.
And thank you. Lord, thank you that you kept me from that. And I acknowledge that you are the one that keeps me safe. You receive, get your paycheck. Don't say, "Well, I deserve what I got." It would be good to hold that paycheck and say, "God, thank you that you've given me a job. And I glorify you that you've allowed me to work this job." Rightness with God is right praise. And it's grieving to God when we so easily will give flattery to man but not praise to God. We'll praise a man for what he's doing or what he's done or what he's given to us. But we won't spend the time to understand that it really wasn't that man, it was God. God was the one who gave to us. And so here's you see Paul's heart and throughout this whole chapter as he's just identifying with us, will some bullet points in our life to maintain a rightness within. We want to pray right. We want to think right. We want to have right faith. We want to make sure that we keep our spirit right. We want to make sure that we maintain, we work right. We maintain the things that we've been taught, that our giving should be right, and that our praising should be right. So encourage you, meditate on these things, and may God help us to make them a part of our life. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We love you. You're a faithful God and almighty God. And I believe I share company with brethren and sisters tonight that want to be right with you. And Lord, help us not to be lethargic, uncaring. But Lord, help us to desire to have a rightness with you. And certainly, Lord, it's that rightness is really seen in our faithfulness day by day. And I believe, Lord, that Paul has given us such a clear outline of just praying each day right, watching our thoughts each day, and making sure we maintain the things that we've already been taught. We're not looking to just learn all kinds of new things, but we keep what we've learned. We control our spirit and our attitude, and we make sure that we keep faith always present in our life. We give right, and then we praise right. Lord, help us to hold on to these things. We thank you in Jesus' name. I have an invitation. I'll ask you to stand with me and the music will play. If you desire to come this night and pray, the altar is open for you. Whatever you desire to pray about. May God help us to not just get right with God, but help us to maintain our rightness with God. A weak prayer life will result in you becoming wrong with God. Bad thought life will result in you becoming wrong with God. Stingy pockets will result in you becoming wrong with God. Paul gave us a good outline for us to meditate on how we can maintain our rightness with God. Father, we're thankful. We pray that you give us sanctity as we return back to our homes. And help us this week to live out Christ in our life and to be a light unto others. We pray that good works will be seen and people will come to Christ as a because of our life. You're faithful, God, and we love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for being here tonight. Tuesday night, service at 7 o'clock, so I urge you to be faithful today. God bless you.